Okay, so I've got 5 slides, and I'm going to try and do it in about 10 minutes because I know we're all probably want to go and get some of the free drinks that Ken is going to buy us. So let's get through this quick. So we had a couple of questions that were asked earlier about pair programming, about how many people are actively writing unit tests. How many people think that they're working right now in what they would consider to be an agile environment? Okay. And how many people feel like they have like a really good understanding of what it is to work in an agile environment?
We have Scrum meetings.
Okay. All right. So I'm not sure how much of any of that is true, and I'm going to start out, everything you think you know is probably wrong, and everything I'm going to tell you is also probably wrong. But I'm going to talk really briefly here, and as I talk, I'm going to say things like, we always, this is a rule, this is a thing that has to be done. And I just want to say, like up front, in an agile environment, this is for like a given definition of rule, this is a given definition of always. Or even sometimes done. Like, we don't always do everything all the time because it's, we value working software over following the process. We value getting things done over doing things a certain way. The reason that we do the things that we do and the things I'm going to talk about is because we think that it gets things done faster, cleaner, better, and happier. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how we write software at Dealermatch, at least on my team. I'm going to start thing number one. We pair. We always pair, all the time, no matter what. 2 developers write every piece of production code. And I love this slide. And I love this slide because this is something I got off of a kid's learning thing, right? That's what we're going to do in the classroom when we're like 5. We're going to think. We're going to pair. We're going to get our work done. And then we're going to share. And it comes from a time in our lives when people were really interested in getting us engaged in the stuff that we were doing and making it fun and productive and rewarding for us, right? You remember back then? Do you have this vague image of how bright and colorful everything was when you were like 5, right? And then you go through your school system, they're trying to get you ready for the real world, right? They're trying to get you like, oh, we're going to get you prepared for the real world. And everything becomes black and white, right? Everything, like all the color drains out of your world. All the fun drains out of everything that you do. And it just becomes drudgery. And you're locked in desks where you have to sit and do the same thing all day. And I refuse to live in that world. I will not live in that world. And we do not live in that world. We live in this world. And that's one of the reasons we pair. It's because pairing is fun. And it's social, and we talk, and we laugh, and we have a great time, and we high-five each other, and we get stuff done in a hurry, and it's very rewarding, and we enjoy the heck out of it. So first we think, what are we going to do, right? We come up with stories that we're going to tell as a such and such. I want this so that I can have this result. As a dealer, I want to get alerts so that I know what cars I can make offers on. Right? That's the story. We're going to think about that. And then we're going to sit down. We're going to pair that. We're going to build it top to bottom. So every developer who works on a team has to be at least competent to do database, web, JavaScript, UI. You have to go from the bottom to the top, full stack. And then we go and we tell everybody, this is the great thing that we did. It's amazing. Look at it. And you get to do that like twice a week if you're moving faster, like once every 2 weeks if you're not. So it's a lot of fun. And we always review our code because sometimes we don't pair. You remember the thing I said? About the always rule. It's always does not mean always. But we always review our code. And this is I do not like this world. I do not like the world where we go in and I have to read all of your code. And then you have to tell me what it does. It feels very much like this. It's a much darker vision. But we have to do it, right? Because you have to have eyes on the code that you're writing. Right? So we always review our code. We always try to have at least 2 names on every commit so that we have at least 2 people who we can go to when the build breaks and go, shame, because we shame people, which we shouldn't do because it's a bright and happy kindergarten world. You see how this always thing works out?
It's a lot better to be shamed if you're 2 people being shamed.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
You can say, oh, I take responsibility.
Yeah, exactly. I'm with stupid.
Yeah. I thought it might also be interesting to mention little monitors that sit around that constantly build the application. So if you do potentially break it.
Yeah, we do. We do have, and that actually comes with the we test and we test and we test 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 test. It's Grinch season. I was reading the Grinch.
I like Agile. Anybody? For myself.
And we monitor our testing, and we have a very informative workspace, right? There's architectural drawings on all the walls. There's story points on the walls. There's a whole wall right now of all of the 7 epics that we're supposed to get done before the end of January. We're hiring. And build walls, of course, that are telling us, what's the current state of the build? Is the build red? Is the build green? We're using Jenkins for that. And it's almost always green. And we test. And we test all the time. And we test constantly. So the question was asked, how many of you are doing unit tests for all of your code? We unit test everything from the start. The first thing you should write on a given story is a test. And somebody asked me, do we do BDD or do we do TDD? That's a stylistic question, right? That's a question like, who are you as a developer? Do you want to write a functional test first and then slowly evolve yourself to where you finally get this full stack to happen? Are you more the sort of person who you want to write down some diagrams, then you want to get into your classes and you want to do some unit testing first and build your way up to a functional test and then back down and then back up? It doesn't matter. The key thing is, you write a test. You watch it fail, you write some code, you watch your test pass, you refactor your code, high five, rinse and repeat, and go through. And so we test as developers. And then we post the code, and we put it up onto the big board, and we test it again. And we run it through the entire test suite and a couple of extra test suites on the CI server so that gets tested. And then we take all of that and we give it to the QA people, and then they test it again with automated testing, and then they test it again with exploratory testing. And the end result of this is that we have very, 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 very few bugs that actually escape into production. We've gone through entire iterations where we had no fresh bugs at all, no defects. And that's kind of the goal of our coding, is defect-free coding. And that's why we test and we test and we test, 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 test. And, all of these things, again, it goes back to we always pair, we always test, we always do these things. These are questions that we might want to ask ourselves, are we doing the right thing on a fairly frequent basis, right? This is how we felt about Mongo some time ago before we figured out what it is that we were doing wrong. It was hopeless. We should never have gone to Mongo. I weep. But now we feel better about it. We reviewed our processes, but we've also reviewed, therefore, our decision-making processes. How do we come to decisions as a team? How do we come to decisions about new technologies? And we do this about once every 2 weeks. We have a retrospective where we all put sticky notes on the board and talk about how we've all disappointed each other over the last 2 weeks, and then we get into working groups and figure out how we're going to be better in the next 2 weeks. And we usually are, actually, and things improve a great deal over time. I've seen things over the last few months where we've just we have new monitors, or the big build monitors are better than the tiny one build monitor that we used to have in the corner, and other things that keep us thinking about the code and about quality all the time, and making things visible, and getting rid of annoyances so that we can focus on code, we can focus on writing code, we can focus on enjoying writing code and solving problems and having a good time at work. And why do we do all these things? We do all these things because we're quality fanatics. And I have the toe socks here, because just to tell you a little bit something about, I have not lost, I wear toe socks all the time because I hate socks, okay? And when you get socks, you get little things in between your toes, but when you wear toe socks, you don't. But toe socks are incredibly expensive, okay? And they match perfectly. If you have a pair of toe socks, that's the pair. There's no subbing out, right? There's a right sock, there's a left sock, and there it's exactly that pair of socks. So, how many of you have a dryer? Does your dryer, raise your hand if your dryer never eats socks. My dryer never eats socks. And it never eats socks because when I put socks into a laundry basket, I put in 2 socks. When I take socks out of the laundry basket, put them in a washing machine, I put in 2 socks. When I take them out of the washer and I put them in the dryer, I put in 2 socks. I count my socks again. And when I take them out of the dryer and I put them in a drawer, I take out 2 socks. Every single time, and I haven't lost a sock in a year and a half.
There's medication for that.
And the thing is, working in an agile environment is a lot like this. Because when you write your code, you test it. When you push your code to the CI test thing, you test it again. When you do the next thing, you do the run the test again. You keep running them because you want to be able to say at some point, right, we've gone 6 months without a production defect. Nothing bad escaped into the wild because we counted our socks. And that's a good feeling, I think. And it's kind of one of the things we try to do because we're quality fanatics and we're OCD like all five-year-olds. And I think that's it.
Yeah.
And we're hiring.
My slide's probably not a big one, so I don't know if I need to go up there. But you know, if anybody's interested, just from a background, by the way, if anybody needs a startup stuff, I'm also the board of Atlanta Technology Angels. So when I'm not doing Dealermatch during the day, I'm totally connected to the startup scene. I know you had something I'd love to give you. You know, just that's my non-Dealermatch hat. But I came there about 5 months ago, and to me, I know a lot of startups in Atlanta. So I think we're doing a lot of interesting things. We've got a lot of interesting people. And it's a real good opportunity. So if you know anybody that's interested in doing agile, I mostly like the West Coast, right? Because to me, I've seen a lot of Atlanta. It's very progressive. You know, please let us know. Or if you're just interested in the problems we've run into Solar, Mongo, or Ruby, we've had all those problems in real time production and had lots of headaches and sleepless nights. We're glad to talk to you about that over a beer afterwards. So I think that's it. I think that's all we have. Thank you guys for.
Do we have questions?
Sorry, follow-up questions.
So, do you think it's more important for a developer to be able to, let's say, run the full integrated stack on their development platform and roll and run all their, tests, when they do a local commit versus saying, okay, well, we're going to say, yeah, it's hard to get all that stuff set up locally. Rely more on a CI server to do that? What's your kind of thoughts on that?
So my experience with this is that you only have to set up a stack once. So I don't really care how long it takes. It takes me a week to set up my stack, and my stack is now set up forever on my local machine. How many hours am I going to save by catching, by catching broken tests there as opposed to like hitting the CI server and waiting until the last guy's build goes and then running my build? So it's always worth it to invest in, a faster laptop. It's always worth it to invest in the time to set up your stack correctly on your local laptop or on your local development machine, whatever it is. I think like the machines we're working on right now, we splurged on like 32 gigabytes of RAM because we
yes.
wanted to make sure that like things would happen.
I mean, I think that's one of the beauty of having, powerful
yeah.
laptop or, desktop
yeah.
machines is you can run full stacks on a lot of
them. Let's face it, not Dealermatch maybe, but how many times are our laptops about six times faster than the production server?
Yeah.
Exactly. Because your laptop's like 6 months old, the production server is from like
it's a virtual machine running on the cheapest possible.
How long do your integration tests take to run?
About 15 to 17.
Yeah.
Okay.
We split them up and parallelize the run.
Okay, so you're actually splitting it up and parallelizing between machines then?
On that machine.
Oh, on
the one machine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
serially it'd take like
hour.
2 hours.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, that's.
That was 2 hours.
I worked in one environment.
And that's not just the integration test, though. That's everything all the way through like cucumber testing.
Right, that's doing absolutely
goes,
everything.
Yes, that's the unit tests, that's the integration tests that are hitting the database, hitting the real, that are actually going off the database and web services and the functional test suite.
Right.
It's 15 minutes, but we run 8 threads. So.
I think it's always that challenge because like if you have a test suite where you have integration tests, and you're always trying to get the time down, but obviously if you can't, then maybe that is better for CI as long as you're doing everything else ahead of time. Then.
Yeah.
So.
Well, so here's the methodology to solve that problem. So the way you solve that problem is that you run your units all the time, especially the ones that are relevant to the thing you're working on right now. And you run the functionals for the thing that you're working on right now and the integrator for the thing you're working on right now. And then before you're ready to push, you just, you do a git pull rebase, make sure you got the latest thing, run your rake parallel. You got 15 minutes. You're not doing this all the time. And then you push. And you do that like 2-3 times a day. You try to push to the server. So you only have to run the full suite the full suite to test the entire application two or three times in a given workday.
Right.
But you're running tests constantly. Right.
There's a tool I use personally, I don't know if y'all do. Have you played with Guard? It watches the file that you're editing, and it's pretty good at running only the tests that are relevant for what you're changing right now. So it will constantly run. And there's several tools like that.
It's like Watcher.
You always want to.
Yes.
Yeah, when you're developing, you're always going to go focus. That's kind of a given with that. Because, I mean, especially if your code base is at all large, even 3 minutes is going to be painful.
Oh, yeah. Especially if it starts doing. I have a question about zero downtime deployment on a larger infrastructure. Like, there are different approaches. Which one have you taken?
Next. So right now we're using EngineYard to do a bunch of our deployment. And so the way EngineYard works, when you run a deployment, it will spin it up as a separate instance on that same machine. And once it's verified the deployment, it'll just swap them out there on the machine. We're doing a migration over to OpsWorks, where we're going to start using stacks, at which point we'll be able to use like an elastic IP and dynamically swap out the stack once we're comfortable and both stacks are running at the same time. So that's what we're currently doing.
Cool.
And so you are, that's actually a good question. So you are continuous deployment then?
Yep.
So do you work
well,
in sprints or?
Continuous-ish deployment. We deploy about twice a week.
Twice a week.
To production.
There's also a difference between deployment and releases.
Yeah, and then so we toggle toggle most of our features. So everything's usually behind a toggle. And so we may be deploying that code, but that code may not actually be production code. We may not be ready to release that code into the wild. We turn the toggle on, and then suddenly a whole new slate of features been deployed gets released.
The toggle, because it seems like extra work, and that's internally with my team, we've been debating whether to start following that pattern or not.
There are pitfalls to using a toggling strategy. So one of the pitfalls to using a toggling strategy is that when, for example, you run all of your suite of tests, you have a very complex set of possible toggles, right? You could have these are on, these are off, and then this could affect the way your tests run. So if you don't early on have a setup, this is one of those things where like, oh, wow, we really should have done that back then, and now we're crying about it, was you need to have early on a set where you're at least running it with all the toggles on. Right, so that you don't get into, so that you make sure that your testing is testing kind of a production-like environment or something similar, and then you have to be willing to go in and yank them back out. So there's some overhead there. But from the point of view of releasing a feature, I have to say it's really nice to be able to say, hey, it's Friday at 3 o'clock, let's release that suite of features. Click. They're released. They're out there. We don't care. We tested them already. We're done.
Plus, it's easy, though. If you do have a bug, you can easily switch it back, too.
Yeah. To a degree. Once you've gone two or three toggles down the line, not so much.
Well, that's,
you know,
of course.
You've got a window here to find that this is broken.
It also allows you to do A/B testing. If you do the right toggling for everyone.
Yep.
So there's a bunch of advantages that we find, and it's totally worth it in terms of the overhead.
How do you guys do code reviews? Do you use, like, GitHub pull requests, or?
GitK.
Okay, so you're actually pairing during the code review then? Or?
Yeah, usually somebody will be like, I'm done writing this code. If somebody happened to be writing code solo, then they'll ask you to look at it. If it's remote, you might look over GitHub. But usually it's somebody is in the office, so you can go over and sit down with them, and then you read their code and so forth.
So it's really, your code review then is just a pair.
When you're pairing,
depending.
Or is it code review by committee, which I've done that too.
Well, if you're pairing, you don't need the code review to understand.
Yeah.
It's just you grab one other person to look at your code.
Yeah, you grab one other person to look at your code, and then that person may or may not go,
right.
You know, grab somebody else. So you can end up with five people around the desk.
Especially
if it's like a big deal,
a
big algorithm change.
Yeah. The thing we don't want to do is asynchronous code review, right? We want to do code reviews where, you know, I can ask you questions about your code, and you can explain to me what you were thinking, and if there are suggestions that can be made, they can be made now while it's fresh in your mind, and the changes can be made without, you know, having this delay in the code review process where somebody posts something up and then 2 days later I get back to them and that's a nightmare.
Yeah.
Right.
Cool, definitely. But you are working in sprints though?
Yeah, we do about 2-week iterations.
Right. interesting that you're doing continuous deployment and a sprint. I mean, I can see where you could do that, but it's, yeah.
Yeah. So the thing that the iteration gives us, it gives us a marking point. Like, if you want to do retrospectives over how you've been performing over the last X amount of time, it's very helpful to have a certain amount of time. Mm-hmm. If you want to track your velocity in units of time, how many stories are we getting out, how are we doing, you need to have a unit of time.
Yeah.
So the iteration is very convenient from the point of view of just maintaining a sense of rhythm.
Did you ever think about doing Kanban versus that, considering that you are continuous deploy, or did you decide because you prefer the rhythm over the...
I don't know. This was a ThoughtWorks project to start out with, so I'm pretty sure it started out right into the iterations, and Adrian was there, so...
We do iterations. We don't use any of the Scrum terminology, by the way. All iterations are called sprints.
Yeah.
And they are 2 weeks, but they are really mostly a marking point to do a retrospective, time frame to do measurement and metrics.
Mm-hmm.
We don't do the typical iteration planning meeting where we book, 30 points worth of stories and pass them out or anything like that. It is really more a flow mechanism. It's more like Kanban.
Okay.
We used to call it hybrid, but it's more like Kanban than it is sort of Scrum.
Okay, how do you handle the planning then with that too? Because that's something that I've seen other groups struggle with, where it's like they're trying to go more Kanban, but then it's like you obviously need to have some sort of you need to have enough input from the team to be able to get at reasonable pointing with a story or something else like that.
We make sure that the top of the queue, the things we worked on, is analyzed to the point where we're ready to pick it up as a developer.
Right.
So it's just like Kanban would be. You want to keep a certain amount on the top of the backlog, ready.
So how do you...
So stylistically, I can answer this, I think pretty quickly. We do a lot of planning by epic.
Okay.
Yeah. So product comes up, they got a suite of features, they got a slate of features, they're going to call this an epic, this is a bunch of stuff they want to get done. Somebody from the dev team has to go and interact with them, discuss this feature, get it ready, read their stories, get them ready to be worked on, right? We have to get the stories to have to be fully fleshed out, have good acceptance criteria, they're ready for development, we can pick them up and immediately start working on them. And so there's a whole process where BA and the product team and some of the development team or one or two developers are working on things over time, getting them ready, getting them prepared. Once all that planning is done, you kind of look at it and you can actually take a slate of stories, and I can sit down in a 2-hour meeting with 4 devs and go, or an hour long meeting with a bunch of devs and slap down stories, and we can size those things almost instantly. And we can figure out, this is about how much work we've got. Because nothing's perfect, right? So no estimation is set up, no matter how much you want to estimate your time, no matter how much you want to plan, it's not going to be perfect, right? So you just do something that's good enough for now.
Well, yeah,
and then that gives us an idea how big this epic is, and we know about how many iterations it's going to take, and we figure it out. We get it done.
Right.
You get slow, and then you fill it back up.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, we do pointing because we're not great estimators anyways, but so basically what you're doing is you're trying to do as much legwork as possible, but you're still having the meetings where you're getting the majority of the team together to talk about the stories and do pointing.
Those are ad hoc. They're not related to the iteration cadence.
Right. They're not related to the iteration cadence, but you're still doing that activity, though, is what you're saying.
Yeah,
because
to bring up the question, but yes. Yes.
Yeah, because that kind of analysis, and that's just stuff that has to get done, right? You have to do it.
Right.
You can't not analyze.
Yeah.
I mean, you can try, but then you won't develop. So.
Yeah. Well, no, obviously. Well, yeah.
Right. Anything else? No? All right. Ken, I have a question for you. Where are you buying these drinks? Where is this place where you're
buying? I have a question for Adrian.
Public house?
Yeah, public house. Yeah, it's right next to the Fox, so I think it's like 2 or 3 blocks.
We hope you've enjoyed this video presentation of a talk given at a monthly Atlanta Ruby Users Group meeting. This video has been sponsored by Rietta Incorporated. As an Atlanta-based Rails consultancy, Rietta transforms high-level business problems into technical solutions. For more videos like this one, please see the ATL Rug videos playlist.